So I've been looking through the Lucky Gunner content archives lately, and I decided it might be time to update a few of those older videos. There are things I've changed my mind about since I started making content for Lucky Gunner almost 8 years ago. There are videos that could use an update based on new products that have come out and new information that's become available. And sometimes I just wish that I had explained certain things a little better. So today we're gonna watch a few highlights from one of the most popular videos in the Lucky Gunner archives, and I'll interject periodically to offer revisions and other commentary. If this turns out to be a format that you guys like, we will try more of them in the future. For now, let's take a trip back to 2015 and watch some clips from a video entitled "The Best Revolver in the World." This is my Smith Wesson Model 66, and it's the best revolver in the world. Okay, let's pause it right there. I promise I'm not gonna stop this thing every 5 seconds, but I gotta say something here. A not insignificant number of people who watched this video pretty much just stopped right here and raced to the comments to let me know that some revolver other than the Smith & Wesson Model 66 is in fact the best revolver in the world. And that's totally my fault. At the time, our blog had a pretty decent following, but this is one of the first videos that we actually posted to YouTube. And I knew that in order to get an audience there, we would have to use some kind of sensational title to grab people's attention. That's just how things work. Well, it did work, kind of, but a lot of the attention that video has drawn over the years has been from angry people who think I have bad taste in revolvers. I did ask for it, though. Anyone who bothered to watch past the first 10 seconds of this video found out that it's not actually about one particular revolver being superior to another. Okay, that might be an exaggeration, but only slightly. I have some good reasons for believing this Model 66 is about as good as a fighting revolver can be. But first, we need a little background. I've always been a big fan of revolvers. What I am about to spend way too much time explaining is that I like revolvers, but I think semi-autos are better in most respects. This video is really about me shooting and studying revolvers as much as possible to find out if maybe I was wrong about that. So let's just fast forward for a few seconds. So for the first half of this year, I shot revolvers almost exclusively. Every week I was at the range with a few boxes of 38 Special and a couple of wheel guns, trying to find that one that would give me a balance of shootability and concealability. After a lot of trial and error, the revolver I landed on is the Smith & Wesson Model 66. It's a 6-shot 357 Magnum made in 2004 and based on the Smith & Wesson medium-sized K-frame. That's a design that goes all the way back to 1899. The K-frames are a good middle-of-the-road size. They're not awkward to use like the small J-frames, and they carry a lot easier than the bigger L and N-frame Smith & Wessons. I picked the 66 in particular out of all the other K-frames out there because of the adjustable sights and the option to get a 3-inch barrel. It's a nice balance between the short snub-nose barrels and the full-size 4-inch barrels that are more common. The gun weighs just over 2.5 pounds when it's fully loaded and in the holster. That's about 20% heavier than my M&P. It's also a little longer and the grip sticks out farther, but I can still conceal it with some effort. Okay, I really should not have glossed over that point so quickly. The difference in the size and weight of those two guns is actually a pretty big deal. This video was supposed to be the conclusion of the Wheel Gun Wednesday series that I had started on the Lucky Gunner Lounge blog about 6 months earlier. My original goal was to find a revolver that was roughly equivalent in size and weight to my everyday carry gun and then see if I could learn to shoot that revolver just as well. The eventual conclusion was that even when I set up a revolver with what I considered to be the ideal configuration, the best revolver in the world, it was still not any better as a self-defense tool than a boring, mostly stock plastic 9mm. In hindsight, what I actually did was pick the smallest revolver that I could already shoot fairly well, which ended up being a Model 66, and that's quite a bit heavier and larger than the M&P compact that I was carrying at the time. But you know, it doesn't really matter if a compact 9 is your starting point. Any way you look at it, there is no service caliber revolver in the world that's as easy to carry as a compact 9mm that's also as easy to shoot as a compact 9mm. I did get around to making that point eventually, but that really should have been the focus of this video. Instead, I got sidetracked with all kinds of other stuff like how much fun it is to customize a Smith & Wesson K-frame. So the first thing I did to the 66 was change out some parts to improve the action. I installed a few different springs until I found a combination that lightened up the double action trigger a little bit, but would still reliably ignite the primers on my carry ammo. And thanks to this excellent vintage 20th century instructional DVD from Jerry Michalik, I also smoothed out some of the rough spots in the action. The final result is a buttery smooth double action trigger that breaks at about 8.5 pounds. I changed out the factory adjustable rear sight for the more durable rough country sight from Bowen Classic Arms. The original front sight was a fiber optic, which I like, but it had a rounded profile and that made it tough to get good sight alignment on longer shots, so I got rid of that in favor of a square fiber optic from Cylinder and Slide. For a carry revolver, you gotta get rid of the hammer spur and convert it to double action only. Using the single action feature on a self-defense revolver is, well, frankly, un-American, and the hammer spur is just gonna get caught on your clothing on the draw stroke anyway. So I installed the Spurless Evolution Hammer from Apex Tactical. I also got an XP firing pin from Apex, which helps with more reliable primer ignition. Okay, lots to talk about there. Let's start with the phrase, using the single action feature is un-American. That has probably upset even more people than claiming that the Model 66 is the best revolver in the world. Un-American was meant to be a joke because I kept noticing people using that word to describe any kind of behavior that they didn't approve of. It wasn't a very good joke. A lot of people took it as an insult to anyone throughout all of history who has ever carried a single action firearm. I did want to make a point that I knew a lot of people would have a hard time swallowing, but I didn't really bother to explain that point in any detail, so people got offended for all the wrong reasons. Sometime later, I did try to clarify that message with another video called Why All Defensive Revolvers Should Be Double Action Only. And that was another case where using an inflammatory title primed the audience to feel defensive from the very beginning. I also, again, took way too many detours to make what should have been a very simple point. So I'm going to try this for a third time, and hopefully it will be offensive for all the right reasons. If you have a modern double-action revolver that you intend to use for self-defense, thumbing the hammer when you're practicing with that revolver is a crutch to compensate for the fact that you don't know how to shoot. In a real fight to save your life, you will not have time to cock that hammer, and doing so introduces opportunities for your thumb to slip or fumble that are not present if you simply fire the gun double action. Running a double action trigger is not a hard skill to learn. You can do it in just a couple of weeks of dry fire practice at home, 10 minutes a day. And once you've got it down, you will rarely, if ever, feel the need to cock the hammer and fire that gun single action. Even on the hard shots, you can quickly learn to finesse that trigger without disturbing the sights. Now that comes with a couple of caveats. Like, I know that some people with health issues don't have the physical strength to pull a double action trigger. They would probably be better off with a different gun, but if that's not possible, obviously you just do what you have to do to get the gun to go bang. I also know a lot of revolvers have really heavy and gritty double action triggers, especially some of the new ones. Don't put up with that. Get it fixed or get a different gun. It's really hard to learn double action with a bad trigger. Fortunately, you've got plenty of options these days. The Ruger LCRs tend to have a really nice trigger right out of the box. The GP100 and the SP101 are pretty decent, especially if you drop in a Wilson Combat hammer spring and then dry fire it a bunch. The Kimber revolvers and the new Colts also have good double action triggers from the factory. With Smith & Wesson, you pretty much have to go with either a performance center model or an older, well broken in gun like this one. These days, I am not nearly as emphatic about the issue of the hammer spur. If you learn how to run the double action trigger, I don't think it's that big a deal if the gun has a hammer spur. Now, I prefer it to not have one, at least not one this big, but if you put some serious practice into your draw stroke and that hammer isn't snagging on your clothes, then don't worry about it. Just make sure that you test it when you're wearing multiple layers of clothing, because that tends to make the snagging problem a bigger issue. I also got a lot of questions about why I would go with a spurless hammer on this Model 66 to prevent snagging and then add this giant rear sight. Now that's a good question. I did eventually have some snagging problems with that rear sight that I had in the video. It wasn't so much the sight itself as the big gap that's between the sight and the top of the frame. Now I've got a different set of sights on the gun now, The front fiber optic is from Dawson Precision, and it's much shorter than the original one. That allowed me to use a much shorter rear sight blade from Bowen. So that gap is now much smaller, and I've also filed down all the sharp edges to make it as snag-free as possible. But honestly, it's really still not ideal. If I was gonna set up the best revolver in the world today, it would still be a 3-inch Smith & Wesson K-frame, but I'd probably change a few things. First of all, I would start with an older model because the action tends to be much smoother and there is no internal lock where the gun's sole leaks out. I would also use a fixed sight revolver like this Model 64 and have a gunsmith machine the top for a larger set of semi-auto style fixed sights. The end result would be a lot like this Model 64 belonging to Daryl Bulkey with custom work by Ted Yost. You get a bigger sight picture, but you still have a nice snag-free profile. For the front sight, I would have a fiber optic insert or a tritium insert, and then I would have the hammer spur mostly bobbed, but I would still want a little rounded off nub left behind. That hammer spur does have one advantage. It lets you check for high primers. You can partially cock the hammer so that the cylinder is freed up and then spin that around when you've loaded your ammo to make sure there are no out-of-spec rounds that are going to bind up the action. But custom revolver smithing is not cheap, and we've already established that I'm probably not gonna carry this thing, so that makes it tough to justify the expense. You might have noticed the plug here in the hole where the internal lock would normally be. Smith & Wesson doesn't make the 3-inch version of the Model 66 anymore. They're getting really tough to find, so I was able to save quite a bit of money by getting one of these that was made after they started putting the internal lock in all the revolvers. Now, our attorney says I'm not supposed to give instructions on how to disable a safety device on a gun, but he's not here today, so all you have to do is just remove the side plate and then you... And then it works just like any pre-lock revolver. Now, I don't care who you are, that's funny. We still do have lawyers who won't let me go into a whole lot of detail here. The lock plug that I have in the video is one that I had hacked together in my garage. I have since replaced it with a much nicer one that I bought from sightpushertool.com. Now, I will just say that if you are forced to shoot someone in self-defense and you do it with a gun that has a safety feature you have disabled, that's not gonna look good to the DA reviewing your case. It may be a little easier for you to defend having done that if you have also converted the gun to double action only, since Smith & Wesson does sell DAO guns without locks. Either way, just be aware that plugging the lock on your gun puts you at a legal disadvantage even if your actions were completely justified. Okay, let's look at one last clip. I got really comfortable with emergency reloads using the Safariland Comp 2 speed loaders. I never did find a speed loader pouch that I like, so I just keep the reload in my front pocket. With this setup, I can reload in about 4.5 seconds if everything goes smoothly. One of the only benefits of having such a low ammo capacity is that you get in lots of opportunities to practice reloads at the range. It doesn't take long to get plenty of repetitions, even if you don't set aside much time to specifically work on reloads. Okay, let's back that up a second. That is actually not a very good reload right there. Speed loaders rely on gravity to get the rounds in the chambers, so the gun has to be completely vertical. Now, I'm gonna have to stand up to do this. The gun can't be tilted toward you or over to the side or anything like that. It's gotta be straight up and down so that the rounds drop free. That's why I was having trouble with that reload in that particular shot. I know that revolver reloads have been the topic of some internet drama recently. I have no desire to debate the finer points of the various techniques. It's not that I don't have an opinion, it's just that I think it would probably be a waste of your time to talk about it here. On the list of handgun skills you are likely to need, the revolver emergency reload is close to the very bottom. I'm not saying you shouldn't know how to do it, and you have to load the gun anyway when you're practicing, so you might as well learn how to reload it quickly. And of course, you're gonna need to know how to do it if you shoot competitively. But if you actually end up pulling off a revolver reload in the middle of a close range gunfight, you very well may be the very first armed citizen in the United States on record to have ever done it. That's how rare it is. Even in law enforcement, I am only aware of one case where it's ever happened, and it only happened because the officer was reaching for his backup gun, but he happened to find a speed loader in his pocket instead. If you're really concerned about not having enough ammo in your gun to get yourself out of trouble, I highly recommend you just carry a gun that holds more bullets or carry a second gun. Even with semi-autos, emergency reloads almost never happen in justifiable shootings with armed civilians. Now, maybe that's because people aren't fast enough to pull off a reload before the gunfight is over, or maybe it's because very few people actually carry spare ammo with them. But I think the main reason is that most civilian self-defense encounters are resolved before a reload is needed. I say all that because I think I gave way too much weight to the issue of ammo capacity in this video. If I were to compare a compact 9mm to a revolver today, I would probably come to the same basic conclusion that I did in this video, but I definitely would emphasize different points. Ammo capacity would just be a minor footnote. Yes, more bullets is more better. They're nice to have, but probably not as important as we would like to think. I believe it's possible to make a good case for the semi-auto without even mentioning ammo capacity. But this was just one of many articles and videos that I've done comparing revolvers and semi-autos. The most recent was pocket pistols versus snub-nosed revolvers, and in that context, I think the snub-nose actually comes out on top. If you think I forgot about the issue of reliability, you might want to check that one out. You can't really do justice to the semi-auto versus revolver discussion without being more specific about what kind of revolvers and what kind of semi-autos you're comparing. It's a complex debate. You can't easily reduce it to a single issue. Of course, I've never been one to shy away from beating a dead horse. Even so, I hope you've learned something new in this updated edition of The Best Revolver in the World. Let me know in the comments if you guys like this format and if there are any more Lucky Gunner videos from the past that you would like me to update.